you end up in Texas?
So actually, I was living in New York at the time. David was living in Florida at the time. And we were just looking all over the country, trying to find that first veterinary hospital. Came across this one, had been on the market for a little while and got to know the Murphys, and they believed in us and we believed in them, and we were able to work out a deal. And we're still very close with Dr. Murphy and Rosalie, and get together with them a couple times a year and exchange Christmas cards. They're lovely people, and they continue to be very proud of Clear Lake City Veterinary Clinic. One thing that's really cool, going full circle, William Norfolk was in high school at the time. He was working in the kennel at the hospital. About a year later, he went to Texas A&M. Originally wanted to become a veterinarian, quickly realized that wasn't for him, so he switched to a econ major. He interned with PetWell for 2 summers, one summer in the business office, one summer out in the field, and then when he graduated, he became the practice manager of Clear Lake City Veterinary Clinic.
PetWell does tend to create like a culture of family and inward growth, I guess would be the.
Yeah, I mean, we want people to be really pleased with their career journey. Ideally, that's within PetWell. If they have to leave PetWell to achieve their aspirations, we understand that, and we want them to be prepared to take those next steps. But we would always much prefer to promote from within when possible. And we do. We really do feel like it's a big family. I mean, we try to, especially when we started like 5, 6 years ago, there's a big stigma with corporate medicine. And so even the way that we talk about things, I mean, we try to be kind of like the non-corporate group out there. Focusing on family and focusing on partnerships is a good way to kind of differentiate in that type of environment.
You said 2013 was your first purchase, and then do you remember when you made your second? How long it took to get the second clinic?
Yeah, so October of that year, we partnered with Dr. McClister and Dr. Cannon in Mansfield, Texas, to buy Mansfield Animal Clinic. It's a suburb of Dallas-Fort Worth.
We have 35 now. Is that correct?
35 hospitals with 5 more on the way. We expect to be at 40 before the middle of this year.
Do you anticipate growing this quickly?
So when we hit our 5-year anniversary mark last year, we actually went back and looked at our original business plan to see how we did. We were pretty much right on the mark. We were maybe 6 months behind the pace that we originally plotted out. So we're pretty pleased, that we were able to kind of like grow within the framework that we had projected and do it in a way that was very responsible and building goodwill, in the communities where we're now located. It's been kind of, I would say, slow and steady growth, especially compared to some of the other groups out there. We wanted to make sure that it's very long-term sustainable as well. And one thing that we've always been focused on is making sure that we support our hospitals. So really building out that kind of like operational infrastructure in advance of the growth. That's an important kind of tenet of our operating philosophy.
Because initially it was every practice has a practice manager and a medical director. And then we had a what was then called a regional operating manager that assisted us, who then reported to you and David Mervin. Now there's a few more folks involved. So how did you guys kind of, I guess, brainstorm and come up with how you wanted to create that stronger infrastructure?
So we just knew the pace at which we're growing, we needed to add more resources, and we needed more resources kind of at different geographic regions of different skill sets. We looked to outside the company and outside the industry to like bring in some really talented, experienced people, both on the medical side and on the operational side. And so, really we sat down for about 4 or 5 months and sort of kind of plotted out this work with that work. What are the pluses of going this route? What are the disadvantages of going with a different route? And so we came up with a new organizational framework that, we think will enable us to double in size again. And so what we want to do is really, when we bring people on board, put them in a position to be successful. And so we don't want to hire somebody and give them a set of responsibilities that's kind of like unreasonable. We'd rather have them kind of like grow into their potential. And so here we are today. We've just in the last, handful of months have added about a dozen new support staff, all with varying degrees of experience and responsibilities, but we're really excited and we think, you know, this is the team that'll carry us into the future. One thing that I'll advise is, you know, with a business as dynamic as PetWell and growing as fast as PetWell, you know, that's something that we need to look at every 18 to 24 months. And so when we sit down again in 2 years, you know, you ask me this question, you know, we might have just gone through a similar exercise.
Right.
You know, we're always kind of looking at how do we optimize, how do we structure our business so that way we can carry out our mission. Ultimately, it's all about how do we support you, other medical directors, you know, hospital teams, so that way, you know, you're able to kind of focus on the medicine and focus on the client experience. You know, that's what it's about. Up until now, a lot of mentoring and a lot of the responsibilities that the medical directors have fallen like squarely onto your shoulders. And we know that, you know, that's a big opportunity. It's a big challenge, but, you know, you need support also. With the previous org structure, you know, we really didn't have somebody with clinical experience there to support our medical directors, support our associate doctors. You know, so I think having clinical directors on the team is a game changer for PetWell.
I'm assuming we're going to keep the annual summits or get-togethers that we have.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's one of the kind of the key ways that we build community. It's something that I look forward to every year. I mean, I think, you know, for me, the DVM Leadership Summit is the best day of the year for PetWell. You know, getting all these key leaders into one place together is just, it's huge.
I will suggest we should have more forced interaction.
All right. Because,
you know, we're not going to talk unless we have to. And you should make us change seats. Because if you noticed, you know, because it was 2 days, right? And so day one, everyone chose their seats. Even when we had the dinner in the same room, no one changed seats. They all sat at the exact same table. And then day two, exact same table. So I think if you force us to interact, you'll get, I mean, people will grumble about it, but we'll make more connections. You know, we'll have to talk to more people.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's a wonderful idea. And we're always looking for ways to improve, no question.
Yeah, because, you know, in the past we had done at a huge conference and like a national conference, and we had like a PetWell day. And then we went to the conference itself. And whenever we went to the conference, everybody would just scatter and nobody would really look at each other. But I liked that we had like leadership topics as well as medical topics. I thought that was pretty cool. For your first year, I thought you guys did a great job.
Thanks. Yeah, we were really pleased with how it went as well. You know, it was a big risk to kind of move it offsite away from one of the big conferences. I think the speakers that we invited, you did a great job, and you know, Dr. Quillvin and Anita did a really nice job planning it. We've solicited feedback, and I'm sure, you know, hopefully next year's will be better. Learn from it this year. And
what is like your day-to-day role at PetWell currently?
So the way that David and I have kind of divided up responsibilities, all the hospital operations report up to him through the operation managers and directors. Since I'm here in the Houston office, I manage the team here. So accounting, HR, IT, marketing report into me, and also our partnerships activities. So I'm focused on supporting the hospitals with those kind of core functional areas, and then also trying to grow the business by bringing on new hospitals.
Do you know, and you might not have this data, but how many clinics that you all acquire, how many of the selling veterinarians actually stay on for a period of time, or is it most of them just kind of sell and then retire?
So I would say off the top of my head, there's probably 3 doctors out of the 35 hospitals that retired almost immediately. Everybody else stays on for a period of time. And we're pretty flexible on this point. I mean, one of the things that we've learned pretty early on, if somebody's ready to retire, you know, it doesn't do us, it doesn't do the hospital, it doesn't do the clients any good to kind of force them to be there. So if they can hang around for kind of a short transition period to make sure we've got another great doctor lined up to come in and take over, you know, we're happy to facilitate that. So I would say, you know, many will stay in their full-time roles. A bunch will kind of scale back to 2 to 3 days a week, you know, as they work towards kind of their full retirement. You know, I think a lot of the doctors love kind of that part-time schedule because they still get to do what they love in terms of the medicine and the interaction with the animals, but they have more free time for their family and for travel and for hobbies. And so it's a really nice balance for them.
Dr. Moore, they had to like, once I started, they had to beg him to stay at least for a week so he could show me the ropes before he got out.
Yeah.
But we still see him.
Yep. No, and he wanted to spend more time in his apple orchard. And can you blame him? Yeah.
Well, I feel like he didn't really retire. He just did something different that required an equal amount of energy. But he seemed happy, even though he won't grow me any Asian pears. But that's
okay. I mean, at the end of the day, we want everybody to be happy. We want them to have kind of achieved their, you know, life dreams. You know, and that's a really important part of the partnership equation.
I kind of alluded to it before, but I think the fact that PetWell has been so open and expressive with their kind of overall goals is very helpful, because it's easy to feel isolated in your clinic, you know, and it's easy to let the day-to-day stress and drama kind of drag you down. But being a part of a community that you know is actually there is pretty great. And I like that you guys are, you know, continuing to reevaluate and adjust that. I think we have very good things in our future, and I'm very excited to be a part of it.
Thank you. Sure. Yeah, no, that's great. And I share that excitement with you. You know, the veterinary world is, I mean, it's a dynamic, growing space, and there's so many people on the outside that want to be part of it. It's interesting. You talked to like some of the sales reps out there that have, you know, work in the animal space, but have been in the human space and now have come back, and yeah, everybody's so much happier here, and that's just a nice place to be.
The other thing that I thought was really great, and one of the reasons that I was excited when I first signed on, was you guys actually had, for a small company at the time, because there was only 12 hospitals when I started, you had a pretty significant like benefits package. Which was that something that you decided was really important? Because not a lot of veterinary practices individually or even parent companies have a lot of ancillary benefits for their employees.
Yeah, no question. I mean, it's one way that we can certainly compete, very competitively with the individually owned hospitals. Offering healthcare, 401k, PTO, maternity, paternity, adoption leave, you know, all these things, you know, I think certainly contribute to, you know, building the right culture. I think for us, you know, we need our teammates to be engaged. And to do that, I mean, you've got to be healthy, right? Healthy at work, healthy at home, healthy, you know, have a healthy mind as well. And so, for instance, we want people to use the PTO, you know, take time off and, you know, make sure you have that right work-life balance. Important.
You and I had kids around the same time, maybe like a couple months apart. And how has being, because two, correct, now?
Yeah, Harry will be two in a month.
Wow. It gets better, kind of. They get more vocal about what they do and do not like. Although my husband and I, now if we get upset with each other, we start going, "No, Dad, yeah," because that's what the kid does. So how did becoming a father kind of affect, I mean, I guess everything, like your outlook on PetWell as a whole, your time commitment? Because I know for me, it definitely played a huge role in how I approached my work-life balance.
I mean, first off, like, I'm so fortunate to have like a partner in Jen, you know, to help, you know, help with Harry, help with this journey. And she's very understanding of the commitment I have to PetWell. So I think that, yeah, I couldn't do it without her. So that's number one. I think number two is, you know, we look at, you know, who makes up the roster of veterinarians today, and it's 80% women. And so, you know, we've always wanted PetWell to be kind of designed with that in mind, and want it to be a company that, you know, women want to work at. And I think certainly having a child of my own helps color that perspective, and kind of seeing what my wife has gone through. She works full time. And so, you know, I'm just much more aware, I think, of what it takes to, you know, for someone to be pregnant and birth a child and raise a child. You know, I think that has helped with the overall outlook in terms of, you know, what can we do to support our teammates.
And then it's fun to watch David Mervin go through it all a year and a half later.
Yep. He's doing it now. And, you know, we'll be on the phone and I'll hear little Evelyn crying in the background. I get it. He gets it. And I don't know if you know this, but we're actually expecting a girl in May.
Congratulations. Wow. In May, huh?
Yeah.
You're doing it again. That's exciting. You said his birthday's in a month?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, wow. So they're going to have very close
birthdays. Yeah, they'll be almost exactly 2 years apart. Yes.